Hey, I'm Dustin.
And I'm Steve, and you're listening to another episode of the Wedding Photo Hangover Podcast, an irreverent look at wedding photography. This podcast, like aspirin, will help you recover from your wedding hangover. Dustin, I think you have a special announcement for us today about what we're going to be doing.
Hey guys, I've got Ben Hartley here, the owner of Style and Story Photography, based out of Columbus, Ohio, in the good old mid of West. He is also the host of the incredible podcast, Six Figure Photography. And as if he isn't busy enough, he does daily live videos. He has spoken on Creative Live. He's keynoted several of the largest photography conference. And he has three beautiful children, two of which are his new twin boys. Ben Hartley, how are you?
Dustin, I'm doing so well, man. Thank you so much for having me on the show. I really appreciate it.
We're happy to have you.
Ben, you're from Columbus, Ohio?
You betcha. Grew up in Sandusky, now live in Columbus, Ohio.
Did you ever work at Cedar Point?
You know what? Fun story. Look at this. Already the first story is coming out. So I worked at Cedar Point for a grand total of 1 week. Now, mind you, yes, this is the shortest job I've ever had. Mind you, Stephen, there was I did training for longer. So it wasn't like I got through all the training lasted. I'd have to go back and think how long. I don't know, probably a couple weeks. But the official time I got in, I was only there for a week. The problem with Cedar Point, Stephen, is as a local, like I didn't actually, a lot of the employees live on site. You actually like there. Well, here's the deal. I'd either end up an hour late to work every day or an hour early work, because the traffic gets so backed up and was so crazy that particular summer. So that was a nuisance. And it was, I worked at a place, it was called Chicken and Fries. Guess what we did there?
Hot dogs and Mountain Dew.
Yeah, it was just chicken and fries. That was it. And it was the worst job I've ever had. And I promptly quit. The final straw for me was once I was clocked out, and this was, I get it, this was my bad. I was clocked out. I was leaving the park, and I saw a candy apple, and I was like, damn, that looks like a fantastic candy apple after working like 10 hours at a terrible job. And I went, I bought said candy apple, and I took a bite of said candy apple, in which I was discovered by somebody else seeing me eat the apple, and it became a whole big thing. And I had, it ended up just me leaving, because I was like, this is some BS. I just want to eat a candy apple in peace.
Wait, you got in trouble for eating?
Yeah, I'm sure it was probably because I was on park grounds, and I probably had to eat like my little windbreaker, you know, those little blue windbreakers that everyone wears. Well, maybe they don't wear them. I haven't been to Cedar Point in a long time. But I had one of those on. And so I think it was that. I think it was the combination, which is fair. Let's be honest. It's a brand move. They don't want employees just like walking around, you know, eating stuff
at the giant caramel apples.
Yeah, I get it. But there was like zero perks to the deal. So I was out.
Man.
So you never had to learn the whole spiel that they do right before they send you off on the roller coaster, where they're like, and enjoy your day at America's roller coaster.
You got to put rockin' roller coaster. No, I didn't. I always thought that would be what I would do for the rest of my life as a child. I would look up those, like, they were probably actually just like high schoolers or college kids, but I always thought they looked so old, and they were all so attractive as a young kid. I was like, oh my gosh, wow. Maybe I'm going off, and I think I'm steering this down a different direction.
Oh, this is fascinating.
No, is it? Yeah. So no, it never got the opportunity to do that. It was either, I imagined myself being one of the roller coaster send-off people, or one of those dudes who tries to guess your age and weight.
That'd be so fun.
Is there a secret to that, the age and weight game?
Oh, I'm sure there is. I do not know.
So you never got to that level.
I never descended to that level.
The inner circle of Cedar Point secrets.
Yes.
Well, perfect.
That's awesome.
So walk us through real quick, Ben, in kind of like a couple minutes or less, how you got from Cedar Point to one of the most successful wedding photographers, not only in Columbus, but the entire world.
Wow, that's a big leap. I appreciate that. I'm not going to deny. I'm like, look, I'm just going to say thank you at that point. as far-fetched as that may sound, I'll just say thank you. Look, I think let me go through bullet points here. I have always done what I love to do. And then I have, and actually just like Cedar Point, when it doesn't line up, I just stop doing the thing. But I try to have as best discernment as possible. And there's obviously tasks that are jobs, right? Like you just have a job. But I would say, you know, even those early years in high school is probably actually where it all began. I ended up leaving my high school junior year. So 2 years before graduation, junior year, I ended up just peacing out, leaving my high school and transferring 25 minutes away to commute to a different high school solely because they had a better art program. And so for me, the foundation has always been making things look good. It's always been creating, crafting something from that point on. And so while most people are maybe transferring schools or looking for a private school, I mean, I transferred to a public school. It wasn't even like some private school. It was just like another public school that just had a far greater art program. Sandusky High School represent. But I think it was that. And I would, man, like I, not only did I transfer schools, but like I would spend I would come home from school and I would just spend hours upon hours working on these paintings in my parents' basement. And this is high school. And I was making like 6-foot oil paintings, like outside of school, like on my own time. Like that's where it really began. So we can go a number of directions from there, but I figured maybe that's just the original foundation that you're looking for.
Yeah. So kind of your initial interest in the art world, was more in the painting realm. And then it sounded like from what little background I've kind of gathered from you and your podcast is that, you know, it kind of came down to the brass tacks of, okay, I need to support my family, which I think everyone can respect that. And was like, I kind of like taking pictures. Let's make a go at this.
Yeah, absolutely. There's always this balance of like pursuing your passion, doing what you love, and also trying to understand practicality. And I think too, the more that I've matured, I've understand that maybe it's all a lot more practical than what I originally thought. Like to be quite candid, if I knew what I know now and I rewind 10 years back, I'd probably still just be an oil painter, or maybe not, but maybe photography wouldn't have even become the thing or a thing that I've thrived in. Maybe it would have been something else because I think at the age that I was, I didn't realize how incredibly practical it all is to do what you love and actually design a life based around that. Mm-hmm. And so when I graduated college, though, I didn't quite understand that. I didn't believe it to the fullest extent. And maybe too, I think there's always seasons, right? Like I think it's easier for someone who's fresh out of college, they're single, no kids, to go and make bold moves, right? And to go really chase after those dreams versus having, a family.
Sure.
So there's like greater doses of practicality. And so for me, it was just graduating college. The week that my wife graduated, we got married. Like literally she got married. Boom. I'm sorry. She graduated. Boom. We got married.
There you go.
And so we were just kind of like faced with this life of, you know, oil painting major, in school, student loans, student debt from both of us, prior, to us getting married, you know, I was in full-time ministry. And then when we did get married, she was in full-time ministry. And so it's not the most lucrative thing, at least if you're doing it right. It's not like,
sure.
I think is probably the jab I would give. So yeah, the reality was that money was tight and we were really trying to take a look and consider what are the options that we have. And you know, Dustin, it's like, as long as I'm making something, I'm happy. Like I don't have to be an oil painter, clearly, right? Like I didn't have to be, but I did need to be able to A, be in control and B, express myself. And so the option for wedding photography was a great move. You know, all my oil paintings are figurative. I've always found that people are the most important and fascinating thing in this world. And so that's what I paint. And so to go from oil painting of figures to photography, you know, especially wedding photography, like I love people. Like, I think people are just so fascinating. And so to be there and to document and to tell stories that show humanity, it was a great next step.
Perfect.
So Ben, are you still oil painting?
You know, I have an oil. Actually, I just did an Instagram post. Go follow me at J Ben Hartley. There's my mass plug right there. So J Ben Hartley on Instagram, the letter J. And I just did a post on Instagram, actually, about oil painting, and a recent painting that I'm currently working on. And by currently, Dustin, Stephen, currently means like it's been a couple years since I started it. The boys really, like, I've got twin boys. They're just over a year old. They really put a damper on things in terms of just like casual free time to relax and oil paint with chemicals in the living room, right? Like, it's not necessarily the easiest thing to do these days. So it's taken a pause, but I'm getting ready, I think, to kind of jump back in here and continue to work on it. The approach that I have to oil painting, it's very involved. It's very intense. Again, I'm dealing with oils, and so it is all like chemical based. So there's that component. But also the technique that I use is one that, you know, my pieces tend to take over a couple hundred hours. You know, 400 hours is not like, that's not shocking to me for an oil painting. And so it's a very lengthy process. So yes, yes and no. Let's talk at the end of the year and we'll see how things are going. Okay.
All right. So we can just schedule you in right now for another interview at the end of the year.
Yes. Sure, that sounds grand.
It'll be a real short interview. It'd be like, hey, Ben Hartley, we're just checking in on that oil painting.
You know what? Let's just make it a DM. How about just a DM on Insta? Let's just do that.
There you go. So I wanted to talk briefly though about how you kind of scaled things. I think that's one of the elements that sort of fascinates me the most about style and story is that you kind of went from Ben Hartley and your wife, the husband-wife duo, to Ben Adams and his wife, to then, you know, this stable of five amazing photographers, all in a very short period of time. You know, there was some rebranding that went into that when you moved to Columbus, and it's just been kind of this roller coaster ride. I mean, I don't know if that comes from your, you know, heritage of being a Sandusky boy, but yeah, it's been really exciting to watch from a distance.
You know, people have often asked this question. We can go into more specifics. It's such like a, right now we're in like super broad zone. But I feel like the question is often, how did you find the photographers that you found? What was the decision-making process to grow? How did you do it? And so let's start with step one. The way that we found our photographers is maybe kind of a component to it. Actually, not. Let's rewind past that. Like, I think this big picture, you just have to know why you're doing anything. And and this is not necessarily a pro. I need you guys to understand this. Like, the reason that we grew to where we grew was not initially out of any desire to make more money. It was never money oriented. And again, I say that as like, it's like pro con, you could go either way with it. I think that it expresses itself in different ways in my own life. But like, I'm not like the super savvy business guy that was out there trying to like create this massive studio that could rack in all of the dollars and could do great things. Like, for me, it was just, I was lonely. I wanted to like, and I think a lot of creatives are, I think a lot of solopreneurs are. I think when you have to wake up, grab your laptop and go to work in your living room every day to make the thing work, it gets lonely. I think it doesn't change when you've got to go grab your laptop, hop in a car and go drive to your studio where you sit there alone and you answer emails and you edit pictures and you have Netflix in the top right hand corner. I think that, I mean, for me, it was living room. It was the bedroom. It was for us, there was 2 years where we just worked out of our garage. Like, and even as a husband and wife team that Leslie and I were, you know, yes, husband and wife, we had each other, but even that, you have this sense of isolation. And this is why photographers are so anxious and antsy to get to workshops and to get to conferences, is to be a part of something that is bigger, to find that inspiration and that excitement to get better, to push, to network, to brainstorm, to like, to hear other ideas and to see other ideas and to meet other creatives. And for me, I just recognized I don't want to wait. Like, I want this to be my every day. I want every day to be a day that I get to show up and get pushed to become better, to have someone to bounce ideas off of, to not be in a vacuum. I think very rarely greatness happens in a vacuum. And I wanted to just create the circumstances that even if it wasn't monetarily profitable, I would simply enjoy my life more.
Sure.
So that was kind of the mentality of where things began.
Makes sense. I mean, that's why we started this podcast, because obviously Steven and I were lonely.
Right?
I needed some Dustin in my life.
A little Dust. Do you ever go by Dusty, by the way?
I do not. I don't.
Okay. All right. Well, I won't start. I won't be that
bold.
Did you hear
that tone of voice he took with you when you said that?
No, whenever someone tries to call me that, my wife gets really offended or upset and like jumps to my defense. And I'm like, it's just no one ever called me that. And she dislikes that pet name or nickname. And so she's like, I'm not going to let anyone start it. And I'm like, okay, whatever.
Love it. I won't start it.
So if you're listening to this podcast right now, please jump over onto Dustin's Instagram or his Facebook, just wherever, and just say, hey, Dusty, what's up?
Hey, Dusty, what's up? Can we back up like 5 minutes and talk a little bit about the J in Ben Hartley?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, we can do that. That's my name. This is going to be a short story, you guys. My name is Jay. My name is the letter J, no period, no J-A-Y. It doesn't stand for anything. My name is Jay, middle name Benjamin, Jay Benjamin. I've never gone by Jay. I used to be like a professional like longboarder. And back then, I used to go by Jay Ben. Like Jay Ben was my name, Jay Ben. But anyhow, so
I like
yeah,
how you casually dropped that. Like I used to be a professional longboarder, like as if it was just a weekend spree.
I started off by saying that I do what I love, and when I love something, I put my all into it, and I figure out a way to do a number of things. I figure out a way to bring people along with me, right? To actually like bring a following along with me, so that way I'm not doing it alone. I find a way to make a lifestyle around it and a living around it. And that was no different with longboarding.
Yeah.
But back then it was Jay Ben. Jay Benjamin Hartley. I just bought benhartley.com because nobody calls me Jay Ben. I own jaybenhartley.com, which will just end up forwarding you over to benhartley.com. Some jerk was just sitting on it trying to get me to buy it. And I suppose he won.
He won that battle.
Yes, he did.
Thank you for that check, by the way, Ben. That was really kind of you.
Was that you, Dusty? I had to jab. I had to.
All right. So moving forward, moving up, do you see yourself stopping with five? Is there like a limit to the growth of which style and story can be?
Yeah, I mean, I think you need to know the game that you're playing, right? And so as we've grown, there's been adjustments that have been made. Like, I think when it was, and it's not that I think, I know, when we were Ben and Les, and even with Ben and Lace, like, you get to really, when there's only, you know, two of you that you're booking, there's certain things that allows. But as you grow, like things have to adjust, you know, like while we still are doing 10K weddings, there's also opportunity for us to do weddings that aren't at that 10K range. And so I think right now we're really content where we're at. You know, we've never intended to grow. Like, I don't know how to say this, man. Like when we've found photographers, we've never been out there like, oh, we got to put out an ad. We've never like, we got to go find the next photographer. Like it is like, this is the question that everyone asks. Like, how did you find the photographers? How did you end up bringing them? Like,
I didn't ask that question.
I know, but this is kind of a part of this. Like, if we're going to grow larger, like we've done it by not trying to do it. It's kind of been serendipitous in its way that it's manifested itself. And we're always open for change.
So it's been organic growth.
It has. And though the willingness to accept when it's on your, like right on your lap, like change is a part of our strategy. Like every company has their marketing. Well, hopefully you've got your marketing strategy, like your whole plan on how you're going to grow your business and how you're going to attract new leads and how you're going to scale and stay in business. And for us, one of those key values is change. Change is the strategy. And so we're always aware and ready for when things need to change, because it's something that you can't always control. So we'd rather be looking for the opportunity rather than waiting for us to like punch us in the throat.
Sure.
So I want to kind of jump back to the whole longboarding thing. I was listening to a bunch of your podcasts to do some research before this. And one that really caught me was the commitment episode you did with Ben Adams. who works with you at Style and Story. And you talked in there about how when you were longboarding, you'd always go out and buy the best or most expensive equipment. And it was like a brain hack for you because it would cause you to ride more, practice harder because you'd spent all this money, you'd made this huge investment.
Yes.
So I was just kind of wondering, like, you talked a little bit about how you see that, like, through doing workshops and other things with photography. And I was wondering, that was maybe 2-3 years ago, like, how is this something that has continued on in your business as you continue to grow? And how 100%. Do you see it manifesting itself now with, like, doing a photography podcast and now planning a workshop of your own and doing all these other things?
100%. Dude, even as it relates to, like, journaling, like, that's what Ben and I were talking about too. Like understanding that journaling is an important component to a morning routine, that to get my thoughts out onto paper, but to actually create an experience that I'm going to want to actually partake in for a number of reasons. One is because it feels right. There's status involved when you have got a beautiful leather, journal with, you know, this stunning, like, pen that is got, like, well, you know what, I don't know how to describe a stunning pen, but you know what I'm saying? Like, there's something about that feeling that you have, the status that you want to actually partake in that, rather than like a Blick pen that's like kind of scratchy and you're writing in like a rip out piece of notebook paper. And then again, going back to what you just said, like the fact that like you've invested money into this thing, that you will not waste it. This is one of the reasons that I actually, you know, I believe in charging for my own courses and my workshops. As much as I want more people to do it, I also understand that more people will actually execute and actually take advice when they value it themselves. I mean, how many of you listening here have gotten the free PDF BS, or you've signed up for some free training online, and then you never take it in. You never do the research. You never like actually learn, or you do, and then you don't apply it because you're just like, I don't know. Like, but when you actually invest in yourself, you fulfill it. Like, you actually follow through. At least this, you'll at least be far more likely to. And so this shows itself in almost every component of my life, you guys. Like, even, and it doesn't always start that way right off the bat, but it ends up getting to that point of just really trying to push things and hack my brain, because I know that I, as you know, like, Tim Ferriss is kind of like this freak of nature. At least that's kind of how we see this guy, as like, he just executes at every level. I know that I am like, I'm so susceptible to choosing the easiest path. I'm lazy. I want to just sleep sometimes. Like, I'm distracted. There's so many other things that I do. And so I know that about myself. I'm so self-aware of it, and I just try to beat it, or give myself a slight upper hand.
So you have 5 photographers who work for you shooting weddings and stuff, right? How do you get them invested the way that you feel like you're invested, other than just paying them
money? You don't Dude, you don't. Like, no one is ever going to care as much about your business as you will. And if you think that that's the goal, you're going to mess it up. Like, they don't. And I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that, but they're never going to care as much about Style and Story as I will. Right.
Yeah.
So I guess hopefully, I don't know if there's a follow-up question to that, but I think that that's the lie, that like you've got to find this person that's going to be as bought in. And if you notice them not being as bought in, you're like, oh man, are they like, what's the deal? Are they leaving? Do I need to pay them more? They will never love it and own it as much as you do.
I get that they'll never love it and own it as much as you do, but I'm just wondering, like, how do you encourage them to be investing in themselves, investing not necessarily in the company, but you want to train these people up to be better because that benefits you. So like, how do you help them to recognize their own like goals that are things that they don't necessarily realize could help your company, but they could potentially change your company? Like, how did you get into podcasting? Was it just something you wanted to do, or did you meet with somebody else who talked to you about it and you saw how like much it was helping their business, right? You know, just little things like that, and how people can help to influence your business and stuff from the inside. This is kind of what I was getting at.
Yeah. So I feel like there was 2 different questions there, and maybe you were just using the podcast thing as an example, but it got me distracted.
And no, that's so fine. Go with the distraction.
No. So the specific question is like, how do you get them to thrive? Is that maybe like the general kind of sentiment?
Which in turn makes general sentiment, you thrive.
Sure. If I want something, or if I want somebody to have a sense of ownership and want to see themselves improve and want to be interested and invested in whatever it is, then I have to very first actually give them that interest and investment back. Like it's attention. Part of it is attention. It's giving them the freedom as well. Like I learned how to be a boss from my boss. I used to work at a graphic design studio in Toledo, Ohio. And that's where I learned through example of what that looked like. And so to really give a lot of freedom. Like there's a lot of freedom, free reins, not a lot of micromanaging that takes place. It's this combination of investing in people, investing in their development and their growth, while also not micromanaging how they actually go about doing that. Mm-hmm. And everyone's different too. So I don't want to make it sound like it's this blanket statement because there are certain people here even that like they actually want more of that direction and encouragement. And so, yeah, I think it's, I think at the start, it's, you know, for us, we really spent time at the very beginning, you know, asking these questions of, you know, it goes, this is great, actually a great correlation. We were just interviewing for another babysitter, for another nanny. And, you know, one of the last questions that I asked the girl who came in, and this is the same thing for Stone Stories, like as much as we're, you know, like looking for a babysitter, you are also looking for the right company. You're looking for the right family, right? And so what does that look like for you? How do you want to be treated? And what do you like? How do you want to be managed? And being comfortable asking those questions. And so it's like it's like any relationship, you guys. It's like talk, be vulnerable, ask questions, be okay hearing things that aren't pleasant. Also, can I just throw this in here? I'm young at this. Like when, you know, for the longest time, it's just been Ben and I, you know, and so I can talk a lot more about that because that's been a lot longer of a journey. But from going from 3 to 5 just happened this year, you know, so we haven't even had that full season under us. And so I just want to acknowledge that I'm young in this process. And I bet there's someone out there who's got a much better answer as I work through discovering what it looks like.
But I think there's something to be said for being not only young in it, but young in general and kind of being where you are in the process. I mean, you could probably count on, you know, 2 hands how many photographers that are your age that has 4 other photographers working for them.
Yeah. That, and maybe, I don't know. Yeah, maybe so. I'm not that young either too, you know, like 31 isn't spring chicken just yet.
Hey, I'm 30 and Steve, what are you? 31, 32?
65, basically. 65. in my heart.
So, I mean, I like to think of myself still as young. So don't age us, Ben, just because you feel old.
Sure.
So
I want to talk more about the podcast. You said you kind of got distracted by that. I wanted to see where it was you wanted to go with that.
Oh, no, I guess my brain was being pulled in 2 different directions. And so maybe you can re-ask the question about the podcast. Oh, I think you were asking like if anybody like spurred me on or encouraged me to, like, I don't know what your exact question was.
Yeah. But. Yeah. No, I was just kind of trying to use that as an example. I don't know exactly how the podcast started, but like what spurred you on to start the podcast. I was wondering if maybe it was something that grew out of your relationships with the people who are working for you and their interests, or if it was just something you yourself were interested in.
Yeah. Just good old me just thrashing.
The 6-figure was kind of born out of you just wanting to try something new, or was it, you know, where day one of 6-figure, where did that light bulb come from?
We got to go back actually, because, you know, part of my origin story, if you will, if I was a superhero, maybe Marvel, I would imagine, my origin story movie, You know, the scene would be set in my one bedroom apartment in Bowling Green, Ohio, Stadium View Apartments, and sitting there with my wife back when we had just gotten married, and we were like, rewind, not had never photographed a wedding. You know, like that, this is the early days. And so when we were trying to figure it out, we started this whole episode. You guys were asking me, what did those early days look like? How did I go from oil painter to wedding photographer, et cetera? And so back then it was the question of, you know, what does this look like? How do we do this? And so I reached out to another photographer to ask the question of like, what is this whole wedding photography industry look like? What am I getting myself into if I decide to jump in this direction? And so I just, it's one of those things that I'll never forget. I remember I pace a lot when I talk. Podcasts are the only time that I don't, because I'm fixed to this mic. But generally speaking, I pace all the time. I pace on stage. And so I'm pacing back and forth on my linoleum kitchen floor. And I called up a photographer that my wife had known back in her hometown. And anyhow, I called them up to ask the question, you know, what does this look like? You know, tell me a little bit more. I'm just curious of what I'm getting myself into. And so like that photographer right there told me something I never expected to hear. I, again, knew I was expecting, you know, you need a 7200 lens, make sure you get liability insurance. I'm expecting all these things. And instead, he told me, don't do it, that I would only bring the industry down. Like that was the only option. Like that, look, just because, you know, I'm some art kid out of college, and just because I have a camera doesn't mean that I'm a photographer. Doesn't mean I'm a wedding photographer. Doesn't mean I can start a business. That everyone keeps doing this, and they keep, you know, lowering and lowering the bar for both the creative and the experience for clients, and to not do it because I'm just going to continue to bring the industry down. And you know, those words really became a driving force. They became a motivation. They became something that in my mind, when I did do it, and I created something that was spectacular for myself and my family, you know, I really wanted to make sure that not only did I win for me, but I could help elevate the industry, that I could help see other people win. Because the reality of his words was that they were based 100% in a fear-based mindset and a scarcity mindset, that there's not enough, that there's not enough brides out there, there's not enough grooms, there's not enough bookings, that if I win, he loses, that if I enter, that he's going to somehow be hurt. And it was all in scarcity and in almost an effort to resist and reject that, because I, you know, we all have this tendency, and I can't be completely altruistic. Like we all have this whisper in our voice that says, don't tell that person your secret. Don't tell them how you shot that. You know, like it still is there. As a way to punch it in the face, I decided that there would be no secrets, that I would help everyone who would ask questions, and I would put it all out there and try to elevate everybody. Because I knew deep down in my gut, whether or not I fully believed at the time, but I knew that the more that I gave, the more I'd be blessed. The more that other people won, it would not mean that I would lose. It would actually mean that I would continue to win just fine. And on top of it, like if you want to grow in your confidence and your self-worth, one of the best ways to do that is to provide value to other people. Like that's like step one. Step one isn't try to figure out how to get what's yours. Step one is how to give everybody and how to elevate everybody else. And this was a huge boost for me, is just to be able to kind of die to self and try to lift other people up and help them win. So that's my long-winded answer, man. That's where it came from.
So where on the timeline though, did the actual like podcast and like, I know correct me if I'm wrong, the podcast started before the live content.
Correct. Yeah. So we're in 2018. I believe it's been 2 years, maybe it's been three, 2000, let's just say 2015 and 2015. I could probably open up iTunes and like see when like episode one went out. I actually don't know. I'm really bad with like this whole like date and time thing. Yeah. So let's say 2015, and I'm looking it up right now, actually.
So you're looking that up. So when you were deciding that you wanted to elevate the photography community and you wanted to give back, why podcasting? Why was that sort of the medium that you chose to best do that?
Yeah, It's because I know my strengths, and certainly written content is not one of them. Blogging is not one of them. I took a stab. If you go back to the archives, I took a stab at that whole like blogging thing and like writing stuff, and that about killed me. And again, full circle, I do what I love. I did not love writing. I did not love blogging. And so this was a way to get my voice out there, to be pretty candid. And it was a great way to distribute the content, right? I could do it far faster with just audio than I ever could with video. And so you'll see even in some of those early days that I was messing around with video content as well. But audio was like, it was the quickest turnkey, right?
Turnkey. Sure. Where do you see Style and Story in Six Figure in like, I don't know, 5 years, 10 years?
Yeah. Style and Story, I see continuing to kick it. I do see it continuing to grow, but maybe in different ways. I could see potentially stepping into portraiture. I could see us owning like a co-work space, like an actual commercial building where, we're doing some work within that with other creatives. This is me throwing, you know, darts at a board right now. Like right. I'm riffing. With Six Figure Photography, you know, it's been interesting, Dustin, like the name came about because it was catchy. You know, I was like, would want to search that. People want to make money as photographers, right? And so that's where it started. But just learning more about myself over the process, to be quite candid, I really don't care. I don't want to say I don't care. It's of little consequence to me if you are actually a photographer. And I certainly don't care if your goal is to make six figures, seven figures, or five figures. Like, I believe that the message that I have is as much for, you know, the single parent in Idaho who's working a full-time day job and would like to take a stab at her side hustle of knitting t-shirts. And is trying to figure out how to partially monetize that to step away from her full-time job. Like, and I believe that the content that I have to give is as much for them as it is for the photographer. And so I actually see things pivoting a little bit for Six Figure Photography. And so I'm far more interested in helping people understand that they have the ability to do what they love, like to design their own life. I think too often people feel like that they missed the boat, that was something that only could have happened a while ago, but they made the wrong choice, mm-hmm. that they're undeserving of it, that's, you know, something that should be set aside for somebody else. They don't quite deserve it. They've made a decision in their life or whatever it may be. They're not good enough. Right. And I want to invite people in and give them permission, positivity, but also practicality of how to go about doing this. And, you know, it's come from the fact that I've heard time and time again, I get off stage, I leave, you know, I get a DM from someone who's been listening to the podcast and they're like, yo, Ben, I've been listening to the podcast for 2 years. I'm not a photographer. Like, I'm an engineer who's wanting to like sell like custom like stocks for like hunting, like deer hunting rifles. And I find your podcast fascinating. Like this gets me really excited. And so that's where I see things going is actually making a move towards really trying to help people step out and design the life that they want to live, including photographers. I'm not going to leave photographers at the wayside. I think it's going to be just as impactful and helpful for them.
We're kind of going more broader, help more people with more things.
Help more people with more things, more stuff. Yeah, I just have to be true to myself. You know, like I have to always make sure that I'm being 100% authentic to who I am. And the very notion of Six Figure Photography suggests that the end goal is to make six figures. And I once again believe that that's not even my goal. And so it feels inauthentic to who I am. But I also believe that even outside of creative entrepreneurship, man, like I believe that my message is also for the high school kid who wants to be in theater, but his parents want him to be in track and he wants to go do him. Right? Like he wants to do what he wants to do. I want to be able to give them that dose of what they need. So yes, that's kind of, you know, that's on my horizon of where I see things moving towards.
I think my favorite part of Ben Hartley, if I may, say, that you kind of have this luxury brand of wedding photography, if we can call it that. Yet you're constantly, you know, you got that long surfer like hairstyle going on, and you know, you're wearing those Air Force Ones all the time, which I love that about you.
But you're currently wearing them.
They, as you should, you know, like it's sort of like this sort of two sides of the coin with, you know, you got this luxury brand where, you know, I'm picturing Ben Hartley in a three-piece suit and a bow tie. Like, you know, when I see your like behind the scenes stuff at weddings. But, you know, I know when you're at the studio, you're wearing Air Force Ones, kicking it with a hat flipped backwards and, you know, long hair. That's my favorite part of the Ben trilogy story.
Do you know what's fun about that is these are intentional things. Like, I think some people get a tattoo to remind themselves of certain beliefs that they have in life. You know what I mean? Like core elements to remind themselves of things. So now other people get tattoos for entirely different reasons. So this isn't entirely hold true. But like, I do the stuff that I do. Like, the reason I have long hair right now is to remind myself that I really am going to continue to do me exactly to the extent like that. I do care what other people think, but in a different way, I really don't give a rip. Like, it's to remind me that I'm going to continue to do what I love in all things in life. And the fact that I love this and this is how I am, it's just like, it's a reminder of that. It's just this little ting that like, I'm me.
So the day we see Ben Hartley not wearing Air Force One high tops, that'll be a day we know he's sold out. He's gone in.
It's already happened. Like, I think like already this week I haven't worn him a couple times. No, it's not like always like this tried and true thing. It's just like in the back of my mind, it's this thing. Cause look, I'm going to cut my hair. It's going to happen. And then probably in like 3 years, I'll grow back out just to remind myself that, that I get to call I call the shots. That's it.
That's a man who's not afraid of balding.
Yeah, I'm not.
So Ben, we've been talking a lot about IGTV, that new thing Instagram's doing. And as somebody who started out like live streaming almost every single day, what was that like 3 or 4 years ago when you started doing that?
Yeah, a couple years, I think. I think two. Again, dates, times, real fuzzy. Let's go 2 years.
Okay. I was just wondering what your thoughts are on IGTV, if you see a way for this to be helpful for you to reach new people, or if you have any interest in it at all.
Oh, I have so much interest in it. I think it's Instagram's continual stab at dominating markets. And I think they're going after long form, high quality content like on YouTube. And they won't conquer YouTube, but I think they're going to end up creating like this own entity, like this own platform in itself, like this own idea that like when people see professional, intentional, long form vertical videos, even if like it goes to become something else, like it's always going to be like, oh, like that's an IGTV video. Like, does that make sense? Like you almost, there's certain content that just looks like YouTube content. There's content that looks like Snapchat content. Back in the day, it was content that looks like Vine, right? Like these vines moved to become memes on like YouTube and other places. And you always still consider them vines. I think that
people are still doing it for the Vine even today.
Yeah. Do it for the Vine. Right. I think that's happening with IGTV and it's really kind of interesting. I'm from like a macro standpoint, really curious what continues to happen as technology keeps getting better and better on phones and phones become more and more like already it's the way that we consume content. But like what happens when it becomes the only way that you consume content? And if large in part vertical video is the standard, like back in the day, you guys, 4:3 ratio was the standard. Square was the standard, right? And now we're at this 16:9 ratio, this horizontal, you know, thing. But I'm fascinated with what happens when our phone and that camera becomes the only way, most, you know, large in part, that content gets consumed on the daily, right? I think that there's always going to be a place for cinema, but I think it's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm really curious to see how it evolves. Facebook, Instagram, taking over the world. Going to hitch a ride with Elon Musk to another planet soon.
Yeah, I'm waiting for Amazon to step up. And not necessarily produce not necessarily a social platform, but a new way to consume content platform, something like for creators. Like I think Instagram is for creators like YouTube is. And a platform that Amazon, I like, cause Amazon just freaking owns everything. And so it just is only natural. Like it's only a matter of time, I feel like.
Right. Yeah. I think they rolled out a few years ago, a way to self-publish books, through Amazon. So it would make sense that the next step of the evolution would be to self-publish, you know, TV series or, you know, short films or web content.
Yep.
So Steve, do you want to move into some Q&A?
So Ben, I don't know if you had a chance to listen
to any
of our...
That wasn't Q&A. That was go ahead, Stephen.
I don't know if you've had a chance to listen to any of our other episodes, but one thing we like to do at the end is we answer questions that we find on the internet. And these are just things that are a little bit sillier, and they're things we don't actually have to answer seriously. We can if we feel like it is worthwhile to, but you know, we don't have to. So are you ready to do some Q&A or?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Rapid fire. Let's do it.
Awesome.
Get ready to bleep me if you need to.
Well, we are an explicit podcast. So.
Are you really? You're explicitly rated.
Well, there have been a few times where, you know, some cuss words have slipped through and I was like, we could edit all these out or we could just leave them in and change it from clean to explicit. So
love it. Love it. All right, let's do it.
All right.
Let's do some Q&A.
But Steve.
So Aryan from the Facebook groups asks, I'm tired of people getting in my way during the baraat and other events, but especially the baraat. Should I wear a sign that says, hey, I'm walking here, or just point to it when I'm pushing through a crowd to get a shot, or is there a better way to get people to move out of my way? I just hate feeling like I have to push people out of the way. No one seems to mind, but sometimes I just wish I had a flashing light on my head to clear a path. Any suggestions?
I think he needs to get over himself. I think, like, and this is me now jabbing a bit. Like, the baraat is not for you. I know you're documenting it, but, like, this is the cluster F for the friends and family. Here's the thing. It's not even just get over yourself. Like, embrace it. Like, that's what makes baraat, like, that's what makes baraat's the absolute best thing to photograph. And that's what's going to get you the best pictures. When you got people, like, all up in your face, and they're to the right and to the left of you, and you turn one way, and there's still somebody right there, and you're getting punch and you're getting pushed and you're dancing and they're dancing. Like, I think it's maybe less of getting over themselves and more of just like, embrace the chaos. Don't resist it. Welcome it. Like, that is what makes a baraat beautiful and amazing. And the, like, one of the most, incredibly fun things to photograph ever. I want people in my face during a baraat.
So for those who have not shot an Indian wedding, Steve or Ben, can you guys explain to the listeners what a baraat is?
Steve, you want to take a jab or you want me?
I mean, I can, but you're the guest, so I'm going to let you go for it.
Look, I'll take as close of a stab of it as possible. It's a celebration as the groom. This is prior to the ceremony. The groom gathers up with all of his friends and family, oftentimes on a horse, could be an elephant, could be a Ferrari, some dope car, and they circle the ceremony location together, dancing, celebrating, where they meet the bride. Family, where the bride's family then welcomes him in and prepares him for the ceremony. And so it's just this incredible party. Imagine like a neighborhood like party, just like a block party, like in the
parade.
Middle of,
like a party,
yes, like a
parade,
parade
combo.
Middle of the street, everyone's dancing, music's blaring, they got people with drums, like drumming away. And so to the person's question, like, it is insane. And no one's gonna get out of your way. And so don't think yourself so important. Instead, like, enjoy it. Dance and laugh and celebrate and be in with the chaos, because that's where the best photographs are. The best photographs aren't when people get out of your way. That's when you're gonna have boring photographs.
Hire two extra shooters.
Yeah, maybe.
The first time I ever shot a baraat, it was in Muncie, Indiana, which is a tiny little town, and they had to close down a street. And so they had to put something out, like, to the public saying they were closing down the street for this event. And so then a bunch of people from, like, the town just came because they wanted to witness it because they'd never seen something like it before.
It's like a town spectacle.
Yeah. No, yeah. It's crazy and it was fun, but Have you ever been punched during a baraat or something?
No, I don't mean to say punched like literally, but just like people are dancing and they're swinging around and they're like on one leg and they're hopping and like everyone's circled around. It's like mob status. Like, to be punched actually wouldn't be like crazy. It wouldn't be a specific punch. It's not like it's a, what are those things called at punk concerts? A mosh pit. there it is. But like, you know, you're going to bump into people and they're going to bump into you. So, yeah.
Yeah. The worst is I think like when you're at a baraat situation or even any reception and like you elbow somebody, cause you're like, you know, try to keep my arms relatively like tucked in while I'm taking pictures on the dance floor as to not elbow someone in the face. But it has happened.
Yep.
Please tell me you haven't given someone a black eye, Dustin. Jeez.
It's not like I check in with them the next day, Stephen, and say like, hey, did you put some, you know, a bag of peas on that eye?
Dustin, do you have a question you want to ask?
Yeah. Kenny from the Facebook groups asks, how do you hold in a laugh on a shoot if something funny happens? I don't want my bride and groom to feel bad, but if the bride lets out, let's say, a fart at a time when everyone is completely quiet, how can I keep myself from losing my shit? Because I didn't keep my cool, and then it gets awkward afterward.
Man, that's a really great question. I usually laugh at things that I think are funny. I don't hold it in. Like I laugh. Sometimes I'll even wait till everyone's done laughing and then I'll give my last little like, just to see what happens.
Ben Hartley always having to have the last laugh.
The last laugh. You know, look, that's good. That's a good question. Self-control. I don't know.
Yeah, I have no self-control on wedding days. So typically I'm the one creating the awkward environments. Typically my wife is the one having to kind of like laugh me off.
Laugh you off?
Like, oh, my husband. And then roll her eyes and that. What do you do, Steve? What's your go-to? Do you just, you know, you're like a cold soul on the wedding day or what?
Well, every time I go to shoot a wedding, right before the day starts, I just take a little thumbtack, super glue it to my middle finger, and if something really funny happens, I just dig it right into the palm of my hand.
Oh,
keep myself from laughing.
Yeah.
You know, it's gruesome
and I'm scarred all over the place, but you know, it's all right. It gives me those rough hands though, because as a photographer, you don't really get those good calluses going. So when you go to shake hands with somebody, they might, you know, they don't see you as like a working man, and they might think you're a little soft. But you know, I got those nice scars, so I feel rough to people.
Wow.
When someone says, "Oh, you must be a sailor," you're like, "No, I just really push thumbtacks into my hands a lot."
No, I let them ride with that. I'm like, yeah. I worked on a wooden boat, and I got a lot of splinters.
Your whaling captain.
So Allison from the Facebook groups asks, I was shooting a wedding recently and it was mealtime. That's mm-hmm. time of the day. Mm-hmm. My contract states that I have to be served a hot meal at each wedding I shoot. I went to the vendor table and my second shooter and I were served Little Caesar's pizza. WTF. How do I keep this from ever happening again?
For starters, you should be thankful because Little Caesar's pizza is pretty dope. The $5 hot and ready's are sketchy, but it is something that, again, I think you recognize that, yes, like, look, I am exhausted at this conversation. It's not in our contract that we be served a hot meal, but we often are. There's been occasional times where we're not. But you just keep doing the thing. Like, I don't have a good answer for you apart from don't focus on the negative and enjoy the food that you're given and then go take more pictures. Like, I know that that's not like a great answer. And it's not even a funny one either. Cause I just think that you should enjoy what you get when it comes to that.
Personally, after doing this for 10 years, I would welcome a Little Caesar's pizza over, you know, the pork loin or whatever.
You know, like, yeah, it would be totally better than that. It'd be totally better than that. Like, I guess this, I expect nothing.
Mm-hmm. Do you have anything in your contract about food, or do you bring your own food to every single wedding?
Me? Nope. Don't bring any of my own food. I expect nothing. And the crazy thing happens when I just choose to put people first in my business, when I choose to put my clients first in my business, love them more than I love the photographs, the portfolio shots, getting published, getting featured and winning. I tend to attract people that do the same thing for me. And so more often than not, we are sitting out with the guests.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you're focused on, you know, the symptom that's expressing itself. That's probably maybe something that's deeper that you should try to line up more.
Do you like being seated with the guests?
I don't mind it. I know where you're coming from. I think everybody wants to kind of disappear. The reality for us is we rarely like disappear, and we rarely like really sit down, you know, like we'll sit and we'll have our meal, but like there's no like that side back room that you just kind of like hide away at for a little bit. We just rarely do that. And so, yeah, I do enjoy sitting with the guests, because the guests, that's like your next clients, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the ability to connect with people and talk with people, is something that, I mean, this is like sales. Right? It's like it's just caring for other people.
Yeah. Awesome.
So if anyone out there's listening that's hired Ben Hartley to shoot their wedding, by all means, throw him a little Caesar's pizza. He will eat that shit up. But not Papa pizza. John's, little Caesar's.
You gotta get better that pizza going on.
Better pizza, Papa John's.
So wait. You would prefer Papa John's? I just want to make sure I have this written down.
I couldn't tell you. Like, I really don't know. I don't know.
Ben Hartley doesn't eat carbs.
No, I eat carbs. I just don't like, I'm actually really bad when it comes to like taste buds. This is also probably why I don't care, you guys, like about the whole food thing. It's because I'm just like, I don't know. I'm just like, I eat stuff and then I forget about it. Like, it gave me the nutrients that I needed, and then I just go and I do more things. So I don't really like my memory towards like taste is not the best.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. It's kind of a fun fact about you.
Is it? Huh. Very nice. What else we got?
Last one.
Yay.
Tracy from the Facebook groups asked, I wore a white shirt and black pants while shooting a wedding. When I walked into the bride's room, the bride immediately looked annoyed. I didn't know what was going on, so after briefly talking to her, I got to work on the details. Then, while I was shooting the rings, a bridesmaid came up to me and asked me if I had another shirt I would wear. I asked if I had a tear or if it was see-through or something else. I didn't realize. After a few awkward moments, the bridesmaid said that the bride didn't want me to be wearing white. WTF. Is this a thing? Are we not supposed to wear white shirts?
Oh, man. That is a doozy. Wow. I feel bad for the photographer. I have empathy for you. No, I don't. I think they'd be fine. Like, it's hard enough as a woman photographer to try to find what to wear, let alone to take out white as one of the color palettes for like a top. So no, girl, Tracy, right?
Yeah.
Tracy. You do you. You did all right. I think hopefully, you know, you were able to find a solution to make that particular bride happy. But I think it's totally okay to be in a white top. Now, if you showed up in a white, like, summer dress, maybe we'd be having a different conversation. I think you're okay.
Yeah.
My solution to this is I just keep a bridal gown that fits me, was tailored for me, in the trunk of my car. So if anybody ever were to say something like this to me, I just go change into my bridal gown and then come back out to shoot, and then I see what they felt like then.
I really would like a picture of you in this bridal gown, Steven. Can that be arranged?
I'll send it straight to you, don't worry, bro.
My solution is just a Kool-Aid packet in the Kool-Aid packet in the back pocket. Wow, that was a tongue twister. So yeah, it's a little bit of that Kool-Aid dye. You're good to go.
Now it's red.
Yep.
Give me 5 seconds and let me see if I can get some of these rubber bands. We're going to do a tie-dye shirt.
You guys, that's awesome.
Come soak your bouquets in these water vases for me, guys, so I can stick my shirt in here.
Oh, my word.
This
is what us wedding photographers have to think about, analyze, quantify.
Quantify. I feel like my other two answers were like a little too jabby at the people who asked them. I'm like, So I will blanket it with an apology.
All right.
It's Ben. Okay. These people, these aren't people from our Facebook group. These are just random Facebook groups I find online. So the odds that one of these people will actually respond, I don't think that's going to happen. I'm specifically looking for like the questions that are the pettiest questions I can find, because I think those are more fun to answer.
That's too funny, you guys.
Questions we get on our Facebook group is a safe place, not a place where we would ridicule and criticize. And unless, of course, one of us asks it, then
yes, and then it's game. Yep.
Well, perfect, Ben. It's been a pleasure chit-chatting with you. Is there anything you know, you've got going on? Anything you would like to talk about? I thought I heard a little whisper that maybe the workshop was coming back this year.
It is. So I do a workshop every year. It's called Abundance, Maximizing Joy, Meaning, and Profits. But look, it's happening. It's December 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th. It's at my place. It's like 3 days long. It's like, it's really long. Cause when I say 3 days, but it's like 9 AM to like 1 AM every day. We just, we go hard. But it only has one slot left. So like, hey, people want to check it out. Cool. So you should probably actually, if you actually are interested in it, DM me on Instagram. J Ben Hartley on Instagram would be the best way. So I could just talk to see if it actually makes sense for you. Cause I have no interest in you coming if it's not gonna like explode your heart, melt your face, and better your business. And so I think it just looked like a conversation, but my guess is that one slot's going to be gone, you know, by that time. I don't know when this is going live.
It's live right now. We're literally podcasting to the
don't
live
lie,
world.
Dustin.
Stop it. Yeah. JBenHartley.com. I'm sorry. J Ben Hartley on Instagram. Just DM me.
Perfect.
And let's try to get him enough people that he has to do another workshop.
Oh, I like this. In that case, sixfigurephotography.com/abundance.
Nice. And where can people, is that kind of like where you want people sent your way to find out more about you and what you've got going on?
Yeah. I would say there's a great crash course for photographers to check out. And they should go, we should get a link on the show notes, but sixfigurephotography.com/7-day crash course. We'll just get a link down for you guys.
Sure.
So they can just click it. But yeah, sixfigurephotography.com/7-day crash course, all one word. And it's freaking incredible, to be quite honest. Like, I just put everything that I got into like 7 days of emails. It is not light reading. Each day I take a component of your business and I turn it on its head and talk about all the things and the stuff to be done to really rock it. And so I'd highly encourage people to check that out.
Mm-hmm. That sounds awesome.
Fun. Anything else, Ben, before we skidoodle? I've got to get to a photo shoot here soon.
Yeah, get to the photo shoot, man. If anybody wants to talk about doing what they love, benhartley.com. Other than that, Dustin, Steven, thank you so much for having me on the show.
Thank you, Ben.
Wait, Ben,
awesome.
Real quick before we leave, though.
Yeah.
What's your favorite roller coaster at Cedar Point?
Iron Dragon or the Mine Ride?
Oh, really?
It's a toss-up. I'm going to go Mine Ride.
So you like those older coasters?
Yeah. Maybe Iron Dragon. Iron Dragon goes over the water with the mist. Mine Ride is so great because of the tunnels. It's a toss up, Mine Ride or Iron Dragon. And also because you can just like run circles and you can go on it and then hop back in line and go on it again and hop back in line and go on it again. And I would take 4 rides of the Iron Dragon over 1 ride of, I don't know what they even have right now. yeah.
Oh man. It's
nice.
Millennium Force all day, every day.
Yeah.
That's like a 5-hour wait. And half the time they shoot you up and you don't even make it over the top and you just fall back down.
Oh, that's, ooh. You're thinking of the other one, the dragster.
Oh, yeah. Top Thrill Dragster. That's my bad.
Okay. I'm a little closer to Sandusky than you, so I'm, you know, a little bit more educated. But it's neither here nor there. All right, Ben, you go get back to crushing it, you know, creating live content, making podcasts, shooting weddings, and overall just being awesome.
Thanks, buddy. Thanks so much for having me on the show. This has been a lot of fun.
Not a problem. Look forward to talking to you again soon.
Thanks, Dustin. Thanks, Steven.
Have a great day. Dustin, thank you so much for hanging out with me today and with Ben. Have a great day.
Yeah. See you, bud.
Cool. Spread them.
Wedding Photo Hangover is edited by Steve Van Elk from Bespoke Tone. You can hit up Bespoke Tone for all of your photo, video, or audio editing needs.
Woo-wee!